Let us now look at the third step of the policy gradient derivation, which consists in adding a baseline to the previous formulae. So as a reminder, we were here, okay, so computing the gradient with respect to the policy parameters of the global utility function was obtained through a sum over trajectories of this formula, okay, where here you have the probability of an action given the state, and here you have the sum of the rewards over the remaining horizon with respect to the current time step. One point is that if all the rewards are positive, this term is positive, and you will see that the gradient increases all probabilities of actions given the current state. Okay, but since this is probabilities, they have to sum to 1. So when you increase a probability, you have to decrease a little the other probabilities. Okay, so due to those probability renormalizations, only the largest increase will emerge. We can improve over those renormalization phenomena. It can be proven that if you add a constant baseline to this formula, the gradient here will stay exactly the same. So what baseline can we take? A first baseline would be the average return that we note bar R over all states of the batch. The intuition is that rewards that are greater than average will get positive, and rewards that are smaller than average will get negative. Okay? So if we use this reward minus the average and we divide by the standard deviation, then we get a mean which is 0 and a standard deviation which is 1, which is a nice conditioning to get a smaller variance. Okay? So doing this does the job of probability renormalization, and this is suggested in another DeepRL bootcamp video which is pointed here. So this gives rise to a fourth algorithm which is very similar to the previous one, but where we just renormalize the reward by subtracting the mean and divide it by the standard deviation on all rollouts. Okay? And doing this, as I said, just suffer for even less variance. The point is that if all rewards are identical, which is the case, for instance, in the CARTPOL benchmark, then you cannot divide by the standard deviation, which is null. So this does not work in all cases. In fact, we can do better than subtracting from a constant baseline. Okay? It can be shown that you have no impact on the gradient as long as the baseline does not depend on the action. So for instance, it can depend on the state. So a better baseline would be B of ST, which is, for instance, the value function of following the current policy at the current state, which can be obtained as the expectation over those discounted rewards. And this expectation can be approximated from a batch of trajectories, and then you get this formula. Okay. It happens that the action value function minus the value function for a given policy is called the advantage function. Okay. So finally, we get this formula, which is the final policy gradient formula that everyone uses everywhere. And using this baseline has been shown in the reinforced algorithm from Ronald Williams in this paper. To compute the advantage function, we have to estimate the value function for the current policy. Okay, so this is exactly the same as estimating the action value function, but this is a little simpler because we don't have to distinguish the actor critic case and the Q-learning case. So we have two approaches, which is again the Monte Carlo estimate, where we regress against the empirical return. So we get the value function and we subtract the empirical return, we take the square, and that makes a loss function that we want to minimize, okay, using standard gradient descent techniques. Or we take the temporal difference estimate, where again we fit state action reward next state samples using the temporal difference error. So this is exactly the same as with the action value function. And again, we may need some regularization to prevent large step in the critic parameters, and this is what is done in TRPO, for instance. So if we want to add the state dependent baseline, as you will see, there are several ways to do so. Okay, we can learn the value function using Monte Carlo method or using a temporal difference method. We can also compute this value function directly from trajectories without taking an estimate. We can do the same for the action value function here and here, okay? And finally, to get the advantage function, we can either subtract the an estimate of the action value function minus an estimate of the value function, or we can subtract directly those terms, or a mix of those different terms, or we can even directly estimate the advantage function as the expectation over the temporal difference errors. So this makes a really large number of possible algorithms to compute the advantage function, depending on whether you have a model of the value function, of the action value function, and how you estimate those models. And doing the using this advantage function will suffer for even less variance because you have subtracted the value function, which is one of those that provide the fewest variance. So to synthesize all those policy gradient algorithms of the reinforced family, as we have seen, there are several approaches. There are approaches where you have no critique, so you can take just the sum of rewards over the trajectory. Okay, you can also take a discounted sum of reward, and this is the same as using the exact Q function or action value function. Or if you try to estimate a critique, then you can take as estimate the expectation over the temporal difference errors, or you can take as estimate the action value function or the advantage function. Okay, this is summarized here, and you have to read the paper from John Shulman to get this general overview. Again, if you have any question, don't hesitate to ask.